have your Bibles, we'll turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 14. Say amen when you have it. Hallelujah if you're still looking for it.
Hallelujah.
All right, we got two hallelujahs. Still looking for it. All right. All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 14. Thank you, Brother Lane, for wonderful spirit-led song service as always. And again, your life is in his hands. Our life is in his hands. Amen. No better place for it to be, isn't it? And in the hands of a good God. Good. I don't care what I'm going through. I always remember, it's in his hands. I can be in situations where, have you ever been in something to where you can't hardly sleep at night? That's why I tell the truth. Because sometimes you just, you know God, but you just can't rest. And then all of a sudden it hits you, that submitted spirit hits you. And you just say, you know what, it's in his hands. It's in his hands. And then all of a sudden you can get you some what? You can get some rest. Now all we got to remember that it's in his hands. Amen. And then there's no better place for any of our stuff to be than in the hands of an honest God. Let's look at, if you will, Paul's admonition to the elements of a relationship between the Jews and the Gentiles. Years ago, my father in the gospel, Jerry Norris, and Brother Woods had taught that this scripture was a compelling argument for Christian marrying Christians. And that's not the context of it, but it is an application that can be drawn from it, but not necessarily for preaching about marriage. It has nothing to do with marriage. Amen. You marry who you want to marry. Mm-hmm. Amen. You deal with that the way you want to deal with it. God has just ordained marriage, but God doesn't tell us who to marry. And if you want to draw that line and go there, there are some reasons to. But it's not a commandment that you just marry somebody that's in the church. Is that all right? So I want to eliminate that out of the process before I start teaching the text, because there is something he's saying about relationships in the text. So let's look at this very quickly. And I want to entitle this lesson, Elements of a Relationship. Elements of a Relationship, where Paul is comparing and he is contrasting relationships. And he puts one on one side and one on the other side. It's important to understand that from the time you were born into some type of relationship. You either connected well with mom and mom with you, or sometimes mom don't connect well with the child and has postpartum syndrome and different things that take place. But relationship starts from the very time that you're born. And as a matter of fact, it has been understood that the holding the child, warmth and comfort and cuddling a child is very therapeutic to a child in his early years. And so it makes sense that we understand that we are people that are prone to or given to relationships. And we need to understand anything. We need to understand the power and the effects of relationships. Do you not know that you going to heaven is based on your relationship not only with God, but with who? Your brother and sisters in Christ, because God has made our launching pad tied into, affiliated with how we treat one another. And we have to understand the most precious relationship that we have is with Christ. And right below that is the relationship that we have with one another. So it's important to understand 2 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning at verse number 14, when he says, "Be ye not unequally yoked with the unbelievers. Be ye not unequally yoked." And I want you to see the word unequally yoked to mean by the picture. Someone get from Leviticus 19 and verse number 19. The picture that he is painting here of not being unequally yoked with unbelievers is the fact that of two breasts that hang side by side. They are not one, but they are two, but they're side by side. There is a relationship, a power, force that we have to understand that God is concerned about. He warns Solomon. He says, Solomon, don't go into those strange women in other countries because they'll pull you away from me. Relationships are powerful. Relationships are not only influential, but they can be damnable. Relationships can be toxic. Some of you are in toxic relationships right now to where you suffer abuse daily by someone who spends their time critiquing and ridiculing, ridiculing and running you down, and you still in the so-called relationship because you don't understand the difference in a healthy relationship and a toxic relationship. Anytime a relationship causes you to demean yourself, anytime a relationship causes you to be less than, anytime a relationship is built upon you always pleasing somebody else, that's a toxic relationship. But relationships are very important. Relationships will stop you from worshiping God. If you think I'm lying, just look at your attendance record when you're upset at the church house, praise God, and when you are right at the church house. When you mad at somebody at the church, that would directly affect your attendance at the church house. But when you happy and feel like I'm friends with everybody, you tend to be more faithful at what? At the church house. I'll be where you want me to be just a minute, but I want you to understand and see this in its proper context so we don't misuse or abuse this scripture. And listen to the scriptures. Be not ye unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship? Every relationship has five elements in it. Number one, it has fellowship. What fellowship? And I want to look at these words up and then be on to my preaching. But what fellowship have righteousness with unrighteousness? What fellowship can someone who's been illuminated with the Word of God, how do you fellowship with somebody who's groping in midnight darkness? How do happy people hang around miserable people? Have you ever been around somebody who's just stuck on anger and misery? You got up this morning and God blessed you with some grits and bacon, toast, you're feeling good, your bunion wasn't hurting, you made your way down to your car and as you were driving, folk told you you were looking good. And you were feeling all right, and then that cologne you put on, folks smelled and said you smell nice. And then you came up to a person who's just miserable. And someone said that misery always like company. And the first thing they do is notice that one little spot on the side of your pants that nobody else saw the whole morning. And then you ask them, how are you doing? And they told you, well, I'm glad to be alive. I could have been stabbed in the head, beat with a brick, drugged by a dog, robbed by a mobster, but I'm glad to be here. And you just looked at them, that's a lot of stuff that could have happened to you. Now, but how are you doing? Well, I'm doing okay. I wish I had. How are you doing? And before you know it, they got you feeling bad about who you are and where you are in life. Relationships have power. And how do you fellowship in an environment where a person is not in a place where they are enthusiastic about what God is doing in their life? Not only is the fellowship in question, but where is the communion between the believer and the unbeliever? And where is the relationship between a believer and those of an infidel faith? And what is the agreement of your relationship? And all of us have friends this morning. We all have different agreements that we have based that relationship on. And how is it and why is it that it seems to be that I believe that I can be, and this is what Paul is teaching, that I can be in the world, and then use the term, but I'm not of the world. I want you to understand that the way the enemy pulls us into the world is by establishing relationships with people who are not of the world. Because we are of Christ. And when I'm with somebody who is not with Christ, either I am pulling him or her to Christ, or they're pulling me. Some of y'all getting it. I don't care what you're doing. That's the teaching in the text. Listen. Look at the scripture very quick. Let's look at the scripture. Let's read it with me, if you will. Read it with me. I want to do it because I want you to see this, because that's his teaching. there's one thing that's going to happen in a relationship. Either somebody makes you better or something goes the opposite direction, either good or bad. There is no in between with God. Either you in a situation that's healthy for your relationship, for you to function, or you in a situation that ultimately is going to cost you your soul. Read this if you will. Be ye not what? Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship have righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion have light with darkness? Now I ask you to read this. Can y'all read this with me? Y'all all right out there? Y'all read this with me? Y'all, I had to spoil you. I quote it, but can you read it with me? Let's start over. Amen. All right. Bible says what? Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship have righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion with light and darkness? And what concord with Christ and the Lamb? All right. And what?
What part
of a believer with an infidel? Read. And what agreement with the temple of ours? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, and I will walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Now I want you to listen to this. I want you to see this real quickly, because when we look at these words very quickly, the question is not only what or how, but it also suggests that it's impossible. Because when you talk about being yoked, the heterozugos literally means that one is connected to. How in the world can a believer have a connection with an unbeliever? According to God's word, Leviticus chapter 19, who has that? Verse number 19 answers the question from God that has been from the beginning of time. Because God knows what influence and relationship can have on your spiritual walk with Him. And so, how is it that the heterozukos, what connection do you have to a drug dealer? What connection do you have? Now, you that are in the world, but your job is not to befriend or not to have such a connection with him that he's able to be a drug dealer and your best friend. His problem should be that if he's going to be friends with you, he ought to see Jesus being offended by his drug dealer. Are you with me right now? I'm not preaching isolation or occultist worship, because that's not what the scripture is teaching. The scripture is saying, what is the connection between you and somebody who hate me?
Right.
I wish somebody had me this one. All right, Leviticus 19, verse 19. What's the Bible say?
You shall keep my statutes.
You shall keep my statutes.
Thou shalt not let thy cattle gender.
You don't let the cattle generally what?
With the diverse kind.
Go with the diverse kind.
Thou shalt not sow thy field.
Thou shalt not what?
Shall not sow thy field.
You shall not sow thy field?
With mingled seed.
With mingled seed.
Neither shall a garment mingle.
Of linen and wool. God has always called oneness and unity in him. When you get the mixing stuff up, you can't mix the Church of Christ and anything else up together and it still be the Church of Christ. It's only the Church of Christ that is called to the oneness of Jesus Christ. What connection does the Church of Christ have with denominational praise and worship? There is no connection. All right, then in the next one, he says what? What fellowship, meaning what sharing is there in righteousness and unrighteousness? How is it that you are friends with a bank robber? How is it that a righteous person and an unrighteous person have bond such a close relationship? And I'm going to answer that question in just a minute. That's the question, because I got folk walking around telling me, yeah, I know that she's this or she's that or he's this, he's that, but our relationship is based on this. And Paul is saying, how? How did you establish fellowship with somebody who is antichrist? How did you establish a relationship with somebody who can care less about what you believe spiritually? And you know something, let me tell you, if there's one thing you need to agree on when you're in a relationship, you need to agree on that God is God all by himself. Because relationship without God, Lord have mercy, y'all not listen to me. A relationship without God is a mess. You need to agree on that. Who God is in a relationship, what God means in a relationship, and who covers the relationship. Because the next word, when he says concord, in the Greek, it literally means the director of the orchestra. How do we have a relationship with a two-headed director? Y'all looking at me funny. You can't have a belief in God, and I have a belief in God, and we won't have a relationship, because I really believe in God like I believe in God. Now you believe that God somehow just accepts everything any kind of way, and I'm saying that God has one word, that God has one faith, that God has one hope, that God has one baptism, that there is one Father that is above you all, in you all, and through you all. Ephesians 4, verse 4. I believe that, and we can have a two-headed God that's sitting on the other side saying, no, there are faith assists, and you can do it just whatever's in your heart. How did we get somewhere along the line? There had to be in the fifth element an agreement that somehow we can take half of what I believe and half of what you believe and call it Christianity. And Paul said, he said, come out from among me.
All right.
Be ye separate. The word hagos, separate means be ye holy. Yes. Be ye sanctified. There's something that every one of your friends ought to know about you on your job. There's something every neighbor you have ought to know on your in your neighborhood. There's something every church member ought to know about you outside of church. And that is that you holy, that you sanctified, that you full of the Spirit of Christ. They ought to know that you showing up love Jesus. Y'all look in front of me right now. I may not be perfect. I'm trying my best. But I want you to know Jesus is, he is the apple of my eye. The word of God means everything to me. And if you know me, you know I'm not perfect. But don't you mess with my church. Because I'm going to stand flat-footed and proclaim that Jesus is the Son of God. That he built one church on the day of Pentecost. That no weapon formed against him shall be able to prosper. I lay my life down for the church of Christ. I stand flat-footed. I don't care if it makes my mama mad. If she ain't a member of the church of Christ, she got to get to step in because Jesus come first. They need to know that about you. They know that about you. See, I don't want this. Do your friends know how you feel about Jesus? Your friend will go because we don't have to be an isolationist church, but we can talk before we have that, but they need to know where we stand. And we stand on the side of righteousness. We stand on the side of belief. We agree that he is the conductor of our lives. We have a concord. We're in concert with Christ. We have communion with Christ because he is our God and we are his people. But people are trying to have the same relationship that God has designed in his word while on the opposite side with the enemy. And my friend, that's why many of us are lost in bad, ratchet relationships that is toxic, that cause you slip and fall. Some of the relationships you are in are the reason you three steps further from God than you were on yesterday when you got up in the morning. You don't need to be around folk who lead you away from the cross. You need to have friends that will stand up to you and tell you you sinning, you know you sinning, and the truth is not in you. You are low down snake. You ought to get yourself together. Y'all looking at me funny now. Because the Bible says in Proverbs 27 and verse number 17 that as iron sharpens iron, so does a man's friend sharpen his confidant. You know who a real friend of you is? The person that tell you you talk too much. That's a real friend of you. You know who a real friend of you is? The person that tell you you don't do nothing but get used. You boy crazy. All you think about is getting somebody. You nasty. You freaky. They're telling you the truth. I'd rather somebody tell me the truth than call myself a friend and tell me a lie. There's a song they used to sing. You met me day by day. And you knew I was astray. Yet you never mentioned him to me. What kind of friend who understands the damnation that await men that are outside the call of Christ will sit back and watch me and laugh with me and smile and on judgment day stand before me and say, you know, I was in the church. That's on you. As long as I make it in. Well, I got news for both of you. They ain't gonna make it in, and you not gonna make it in either. Because if you was a friend, you proclamate, you preach, proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to everybody you see. That's what God says in Matthew chapter 20, verse 19. He said, go ye therefore into all the land. I want you to preach and to teach the gospel, the things that I have told you to observe, whatsoever I told you to observe. And he said, I want you to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Somebody asked me, Brother Hamilton, can you have a friend outside the church? You can have a friend you convert outside the church, but in the freeing of a sense of fellowship and concord, in communion, in agreement, in belief. No, you can't have a friend with a different five-element structure than that, because the Bible says in James chapter 4 and verse number 4, he said, don't you know, this is the NIV version, he said, don't you know he that has a friend that hated God has become an enemy to God? Therefore, whosoever is a friend to that person who hates God, how does he hate God? He don't believe in the Bible. He doesn't believe in the church. He doesn't have an agreement that God is his master. He has no communion with God. He believes in something altogether different. He said, when you make a friend with that monster, he said, you have become an enemy with God. Y'all got quiet. Y'all got a bunch of friends. Amen. Y'all got a friend. Y'all back to the Bible I go. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 33. Listen to the Bible. He said, be not deceived. Evil communication. Evil fellowship. Let me tell you something. I'm cool as ice water. I'm cool like that. I have to be careful with friends that I have around me, because I'm also learning to be the best Christian I can be. If you learn to be a good Christian, won't y'all say amen?
Amen.
Unless you got it all together. But I got some friends that don't think like I think. And sometimes we be walking around and talking and laughing. And then you're saying some words. Well, I know some words too. And I didn't mean to start cussing. I wish I had five people full of Holy Ghost up in here. But since I'm with my friends, and it's, y'all ought to stop, and some of y'all don't cuss me. Y'all act right now. But I'm sitting around minding my own business, and I can get around certain folk that I call friend, and I lose my separate, my hagos, my holiness, my sanctification, and before you know it, I'm cussing hard. I'm teaching them how to cuss. They ain't never said a bad word. All I got to do is call them and talk about the offering. They start cussing this morning. Amen. Anyhow, it's healthy to the church. But I have noticed, and I don't know about you, but I have noticed that the Bible is right. 1 Corinthians 15, 33. I've noticed that when I'm around folk who are in that, who are hagos, who are separate, when I'm around Alvin, and I'm around folk that don't use that type of language, and I'm around folk who are monitoring me, and some folk waiting on me to mess up, that all of a sudden I don't talk like I was talking with them other folk. All of a sudden, I find myself doing better with Christ. Well, what are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that perhaps there is something to 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 14, that the people who I have fellowship with, the people I have an agreement with, the people I have a concert with, the people I have communion with, the people that I have a relationship with in Christ are better for me spiritually than the people who are outside of Christ, because the people outside of Christ seem to be dragging me outside of Christ. And then sometimes we get into it because I'm trying to pull them into Christ. Why not be with folk who are like mine, of the same spiritual value, of the same belief, and encourage and push each other forward in Christ Jesus? Why can't we do that? Why can't we do that, church? Why can't we do that? Now, only the hypocrites in here right now are sitting around, because demons like to try to find something. They say, see, that he can use some bad words. You use some bad words too. I can look at the way your mouth shape. I know you use some bad words. I can look at you. You seem to look like you want. You probably teach me some cuss words. And I only cuss in English. I bet you cuss in Spanish. I bet you can cuss. I bet you are a bilingual cusser. You seem to look at me if you want to. But you ain't holy. You ain't all of that. And the problem is that you've been lying so much, just like them folk out in the world. You believe the lie you're telling yourself. We need to watch who we fellowship with and how we carry ourselves and who we with at all times, lest we slip. Then Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 31, he said very clearly, he said, I have to watch myself and bring myself under bondage, unless I too become a castaway. At any given time, you can be influenced to walk away from Christ instead of walk to Christ. And that influence normally comes from the enemy himself. So So we have to watch the culture. We have to watch our company. We have to watch our spirit. We have to make sure that we are not walking around with folk who don't believe, who don't have concert, who don't have concord with Christ Jesus. The elements of a good relationship is to recognize that the world is trying to transform us and conform us to their behavior versus us setting the standards in the behavior. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 14 is the standard setting. It's the standard. It's saying that Christians don't act like everybody else. Well, if they don't act like everybody else, we don't worship like who? We don't worship like everybody else. We don't do what everybody else do. Do we sin and make mistakes? Yes, we sin and make mistakes. Does the enemy try to get us? Yes, he tries to get us. But our job is to influence the world to Christ and not away from Christ. Can I ask you a question right quick? What type of relationship are you in? Are you in a relationship to where your spouse is leading you away from Christ? Some of the reasons that you're not as close to God as you would is that you're not worshiping together with your spouse. Your spouse has her own mind, has her own thought process, her own thing, and you found a way to justify it. And Paul is saying, how did that happen? He said, how in the world did that happen? I put you as the head of the house. When Joshua stood up, he said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I didn't tell you to go check with her and ask her what she wanted to do. You were the head of the house. I told you to lead the house. And when you get up in the morning, if she a woman of God, she would get up if she's in a relationship with God and go where you go as long as it's right in Christ Jesus. Now, whatever demonic spirit you're using to justify allowing that type of behavior, that's between you and God. But I think your problem is going to be is that you've developed a communion that's outside of the scriptures of God. Let me tell you what I mean by that. That what makes a denomination and what makes a person outside of God's graces is when they get outside of the word of God. Are y'all with me so far? All right, so watch this. A church, when Jesus said in Matthew 6:18, upon this rock I'll build my church. Here's relationship. I have a relationship with the church. Upon the rock I'll build a church. The definition of the word church does not have denomination in it. Don't have it anywhere in it. The church, nowhere does it say many people, does it, but a church, the definition of a church is also tied into the belief and the doctrine of the church that makes it the church. 2 John verse number 9, whosoever transgresseth and bringeth not this doctrine, hath not God. But whosoever bringeth this doctrine, hath both the Father and the Son. If any come unto you and don't